Hey everyone, this is Josh with another Bitcoin and blockchain tutorial available at chaintuts.com. And today we're going to be talking about the topic of Bitcoin privacy. And specifically, we're going to be talking about a broad algorithm known as CoinJoin. It's really important to remember that although many people think Bitcoin is anonymous, this blockchain is actually not anonymous at all. It's really only pseudonymous. Users transact using addresses that are generated by their wallets, but it's actually quite easy in most cases to track the flow of coins between different addresses on the network. While these blockchains are a fascinating way to do decentralized and peer-to-peer money, they're not private or fungible in their fundamental design. Fungibility is the concept that, you know, individual tokens of a currency are indistinguishable from one or another. So for example, dollar bills are fungible. You really can't tell the difference between one dollar bill or another as this cash currency is exchanged around. But with Bitcoin, Bitcoin Cash, Litecoin, and many other UTXO blockchains, coins actually are traceable as they flow between different users on the network. And since privacy is an important part of money, one way that this can be solved on these UTXO blockchains is using various implementations of a CoinJoin algorithm. So let's discuss what that means. With a normal Bitcoin transaction, there's a flow of UTXO inputs that are consumed by that transaction, and then new outputs owned by the receiving addresses that are created. I just released my last tutorial, which discusses UTXOs in depth. So if you're not familiar with this concept that's important to understanding CoinJoins, check out that tutorial first and come back to this one. But let's say, for example, we have Bob, and Bob has a 1 Bitcoin UTXO in his wallet and wants to send 0.5 Bitcoin to another user on the network. In a normal transaction, Bob would create his own transaction with his wallet that would send a new 0.5 Bitcoin output owned by the receiving address and another 0.5 Bitcoin UTXO that goes back to his wallet as change. Now, this simple example is omitting miner fees, but that's something that also occurs as part of the transaction. So with all of these transactions that are generally done between from one user's wallet to maybe multiple other users' wallets, it's very easy for chain analysis to be done to track the flow of coins. So coin joins can be used to help obscure the flow of funds between users and make it less possible to track who is sending what. So what coin joins do is they combine many users' inputs and outputs into one gigantic transaction with many equally sized outputs. And when I say equally sized, I mean equally sized in value. So for example, a CoinJoin transaction might have many outputs of 0.5 BTC. This makes it difficult to trace the flow of coins between users because you can't distinguish between all of these different outputs in the same transaction that have equal value. So let's look at a simple example of a CoinJoin transaction. In this case, maybe Bob has his 1 BTC UTXO, and he's going to consume that entirely and shuffle his coins in this CoinJoin transaction and get back to 0.5 BTC coins back to his new addresses. Another user has a 0.5 BTC input and simply shuffles that 0.5 BTC back. And we have a third user in this case that's actually sending that 0.5 BTC to another receiver. But you'll notice for all of these users, they have a few different sized inputs, but the transaction produces four outputs of 0.5 BTC. And for someone doing blockchain analysis, then it becomes very difficult to tell what coins are going where over these different transactions that'll occur with these outputs later. Now, there are some concerns with CoinJoin that are important for making sure that this algorithm works well. And there are many other points that I'm also not going to make in this tutorial. This is a fairly complex topic, and it's very important that CoinJoins are done correctly by users in order to preserve their privacy. But one concern is you generally want to avoid change. So it's best when you're doing a CoinJoin transaction to consume an entire UTXO to then send to a receiver or potentially shuffle back to yourself as part of these many equally sized outputs. When you have normal change that is distinguishable because you, for example, sent 0.5 BTC and then had a quarter BTC come back to you, those change outputs can be traced in future transactions. So someone would at least know that you were part of this CoinJoin. Also, the more the merrier. The more people that participate in a CoinJoin transaction, the greater the size of what is called the anonymity set. And so if you have three users doing a CoinJoin, it's less secure and less privacy preserving than 10 users doing a CoinJoin, because it simply obscures the addresses more and more and makes the chain analysis harder to do. Now, a final very important point that I want to make about CoinJoins is CoinJoin itself is a pretty broad sort of algorithm. And the one very important problem that CoinJoin does not solve is how to actually find other users on the Bitcoin network to do these CoinJoins with. That's up to the individual implementation of a CoinJoin style algorithm. So let's talk about some implementations then. Well, the first sort of implementation that came about on the Bitcoin network is not a very good one, and that is centralized mixing services. There are many problems with using a centralized trusted mixing service to try and preserve your privacy. The first is many of these were simply scams and would steal users' coins outright. And the second is when you have a centralized mixing service, it's possible for chain analysis to be done to at least see which outputs are created by the mixer, and those coins are often blacklisted by exchanges and other services that users might want to use. So centralized mixers are a bad idea. Don't use them. Now, there are several decentralized and trustless implementations of CoinJoins that are much better that have been developed. And it largely depends on what network you wish to transact on as to which CoinJoin implementation that you will use. On BTC Bitcoin, the Wasabi wallet uses its zero-link protocol for CoinJoins. And again, this is a decentralized and trustless algorithm. Bitcoin Cash now uses the cash shuffle algorithm, which is integrated into several wallets like Electron Cash and others. And finally, the Litecoin community is working on a CoinJoin implementation called Mimblewimble, which is a very exciting development for that community. So all of these implementations have decentralized and trustless ways of helping you find other users on the network to do the CoinJoins with. So you never have to trust a centralized service. You don't have to worry about any sort of blacklisting or money laundering type issues with these because they're done in a way that doesn't require trust or a centralized service. So these are great ways to help protect your privacy. Now, again, it's really important that CoinJoins are used correctly. There are many somewhat complex concerns with making sure that your privacy is fully protected using CoinJoin algorithms, but it's a great step in the right direction for cryptocurrencies that use this UTXO blockchain model. So as always, there is a written tutorial on the Chain Tutorials website that accompanies this video. And again, if you're a little bit fuzzy on the concept of UTXO transactions, I encourage you to check out that tutorial that explains how these transactions work. And as always, I want to thank you very much for listening, and I hope you're well.